All right, welcome back. It is the Vegas Take, Sharp and Shapiro. By the way, a quick rundown on the show tomorrow. The guy who is the Storm Area 51 founder, who just abruptly canceled the Alien Stock Festival, founder Matty Roberts. He'll give us his reasons why. He's going to be joining us in studio tomorrow. That is going to be very, very interesting. Former UNLV quarterback, in fact, the last quarterback to get UNLV to a bowl game, Caleb Herring, will be joining us tomorrow as well. We're going to have Mike Babcock from TMZ Sports, and I know JD is really, really excited about these guests that are coming in tomorrow. We're going to have the guys from guess what? Guess what, JD? Guess what show? Chippendales. That's right. The guys from Chippendales will be in
studio
tomorrow.
You didn't even let me guess.
Well, you would have guessed it anyway. I know.
No,
you've been,
I was thinking Thunder from Down Under.
You had that marked down on your calendar for months. I know.
No, I've seen the poster in your room.
Oh, you have?
I have.
Yeah, I'm trying to get him to sign them. Anyway, so that's a big show lined up tomorrow, and I'm sure those who are not in favor of the cross-dressers reading at the library will probably be not in favor somehow, I think, of Chippendales in studio either, but too bad. They're coming in anyway, and it's going to be a lot of fun. So joining us on the line right now, he joins us every week. We call him Mr. X, the Hollywood conservative, and the reason why we call him that, he's a longtime Hollywood producer. And he happens to be a Trump supporter. He happens to be on the right. And we really enjoy getting his perspective on things. Mr. X, thank you so much for joining us. How are you?
What's up, Mr. X?
I'm actually pretty shook. I did not know that Storm Area 51 was canceled. I was preparing. I was ready. I'm pretty upset right now.
Well, I mean, it'll be interesting to see if people show up. But we know that the Alien Stock Festival was shut down. And this guy's going to give us his reasons for it tomorrow.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah. You're welcome to call in tomorrow. And ask Matty some questions.
I was planning on storming it and coming out with a microwave that microwaves only my food and not the plate. This was supposedly the hidden technology that's in Area 51, and now I can't get that, so I'm pretty upset.
Well, you know, people that maybe show up to that motel out there, I think it's $60 a night. I'm pretty sure they're booked. But there is a restaurant out there. Supposedly, they serve great burgers. So there is there's some things
to
do out there.
Don't tell that to Kamala Harris, but okay. Fair enough.
I'll try not to. All right, Mr. X, let's start with a conversation that we've had today. It's a hot topic, a big local story, and it's actually turned into a national story where you have these cross-dressers, men dressed as women, who are reading books to children in libraries. There's very divided on this issue. People either oppose it or they don't. What do you make of this issue?
I have a very hot take on this. Are you guys ready?
We're ready.
I'm prepared.
Who cares? God, I mean, seriously, like, who cares? Like, I have kids, and here's the bottom line. Like, for me, if I went into a library and there was a tranny in there reading books to kids, my daughter, who's 6 years old, would say, "Daddy, why? What's wrong with that person? Why is that a man dressed up as a woman?" And I would just say, "Hey, there's men in this world who like to dress up as women and women who like to dress up as men, and that's life. And when you're a little bit older, you'll understand it." Like, what's the big deal?
That is exactly the appropriate answer that a responsible parent should say.
Yeah, well, it's all about safeguards. Are they making sure that there's no sex offenders involved, et cetera, et cetera? Is our background checks instituted? And I do think that it probably has a more profound effect on young boys than young girls for a number of reasons. That being said, let's talk about the Democratic debate tonight. How do you think it's going to go? Do you think Joe Biden is going to make up ground? And will he end up blind before the end of the debate?
Will he bleed from his eye again? I texted you that picture of that. That was horrifying.
Hey, can I just say this? Donald Trump, I think, might respond by saying that Joe Biden, he was bleeding from his eye, bleeding from wherever. That would be funny if Trump did say that. If you remember, he did say that about Megyn Kelly.
Remember.
Yeah.
That was great.
Sorry, go ahead.
That was one of his memorable quotes. No, I mean, it's crazy how hard, you know, this is all heating up and really ramping up for next year. I mean, there's these impeachment talks, which I'm sure will be, you know, people talking about that. There's definitely not going to happen. You can't impeach a president just because you don't like him. And, you know, you can try. I mean, I don't know if that's going to happen. But no, I mean, I think that the debate is just going to be another disaster, just like the previous ones have been. Like, I think I honestly, I don't pay enough attention to the Democratic Party to even really know who the front runner is. I always assumed it was Biden, but he's literally falling apart. Like the guy, he's honestly like the guy from Weekend at Bernie's. He's like Bernie in Weekend at Bernie's too. Like they've resurrected him with some voodoo magic and just.
Hey, wait a second! Oh, you just came up with a great idea. Okay, you're a Hollywood producer. How do you think your fellow co-workers would feel if you came up with a script that said Weekend at Joe's?
Wait, that's not a bad idea, actually. And like, or the Democrats desperate.
It'd be a good short.
To oppose Trump, like, you know, resurrect Richard Nixon from the dead or something and bring him out against Trump. I don't know.
I think you could reach out to Will Ferrell at Funny or Die and create a nice short with that.
Who would you pick? Yeah, that was my next question, Mr. X. Who would you pick to play a dead Joe Biden?
Just Joe Biden. I would just find his corpse because he's already dead, so we could just actually get him to play.
Oh, that's horrible. You're being so mean to Joe.
Maybe dead Paul Newman could play him. Like, we'd have to see what stage of decomposition his body is in, and then he might work for it.
That's so horrible.
Yeah. Well, you know, what are you going to say? I'm a Republican.
Well, we'll have to wait. No, that's okay. Well, we'll have to wait and see how these debates play out. And, of course, we'll get your reaction to it next week when you come on the show. All right, so a lot has transpired here in the last week. What do you make of John Bolton and basically getting bolted out of his position by Donald Trump and that whole Camp David situation with the Taliban? What do you make of all that?
That was baffling to me. Like, I didn't understand. So Trump actually welcomed members of the Taliban to Camp David?
My understanding, and based on all the reports, is that Mike Pence was in that room, Pompeo was in that room, Bolton was in that room, and Bolton is no stranger to disagreeing with Donald Trump. They're all in a room. This happened
And Bolton is very, very. I mean, he's war hungry. He likes going to war.
So 2 weeks ago, they're in this room. And Donald Trump wanted to invite members of the Taliban who there's no doubt about this. They have harbored terrorists in Al-Qaeda. OK, he wanted to invite them into a room to Camp David. And when his response to the media was, well, it could have been the White House, but you guys wouldn't have liked that very much. So I chose Camp David. That was his response, which is so out there ridiculous. So, of course, Bolton disagreed. Vice President Mike Pence disagreed. Basically, everybody in the room disagreed except for that blowhard Pompeo, who does anything the president asked him to do. So, I mean, that's basically what happened. And then later, 24 hours, or I should say a week later, Bolton claimed that he would resign. And Donald Trump said, well, let's wait till the next day and let's talk about it. And then Trump didn't wait till the next day. He fired him. That's the story from what I understand.
It's interesting. I mean, what are the Taliban up to these days? That's honestly my question. Like, what was the purpose of this meeting, I suppose? Like, I'm never opposed to, like, trying to settle things with foreign countries or, I guess, in this situation, you know, former terrorist groups, you know, to attempt to stop with all of the nonsense. But, yeah, I mean, they could have probably chosen a different location for that. They could have gone to, like, a Marriott or something like that. And, you know, I'm sure it would have been less controversial. So, I mean, yeah, it seems like it was probably justified that this guy got canned. And I'm sure that we'll see him on Dancing with the Stars next season or something like that.
Right. Right next to Sean Spicer.
Yeah, that's incredible. I seriously cannot believe that. But yeah, and honestly, guys, the thing that to me, the hottest topic I've been seeing a lot of is Trump trying to ban vapes is one of the most baffling. Again, like
we talked about that first segment. We talked about that first segment, Mr. X, and I said, listen, you have all these issues when it comes to mass shootings and all these people that are dying when it comes to mass shootings. Yes, we've had 6 people die from vaping, and what a lot of people are saying, it's the cartridges that they're buying and, you know, the oil that's in there, and it's got nothing to do with actual vaping itself. But what does Donald Trump do? Immediately, he's going to put something in paper, and in 2 weeks, a lot of these are going to be banned. And I say to myself, if it's so easy for him to do something like that, why can't he do something, you know, gun control, mass shootings? And we've had a couple of people call in that agree with what I'm saying. It's about money. And this vape industry, it's not the same money that we're talking about when it comes to the NRA and gun sales.
Referencing lobbyists.
Well, and you didn't even mention the one that's actually a far bigger issue than any of that is the opioid crisis.
Sure.
And that's the one where there's the most pharmaceutical money. And they're so deep in the pockets of all these politicians that that's why they keep getting away.
Yeah.
And the vape, you know, the vape industry, whatever it is, a bunch of potheads and their little weird shops. Like, they, I guess it's just kind of an easy target for Trump, and one that, like, really, other than the millennials that vape, are going to have an issue with. But, I mean, it's like, talk about misdirection. It's just like, come on, man.
No, really, I agree.
Like, you sit down at your desk in the White House and go, okay, here's the problems with America today. Like you said, you've got mass
right.
You've got the opioid epidemic. Yeah. You know what I hate are those guys that smoke those flavored cigarettes. Let's get
rid of
those.
Well, I think second on his list were cross-dressers that are reading books in libraries. That might have been.
He has not mentioned that yet.
No, but I wanted to ask you, if I may, about Ted Cruz. Since you are in Hollywood, you are the Hollywood conservative. I don't know if you've ever met Alyssa Milano before, but Alyssa Milano and Ted Cruz had been going at it the last several weeks about gun control on social media. I do give Ted Cruz credit because he invited Alyssa Milano in yesterday. They had a conversation. We don't know exactly what took place there, but from what I hear on both sides, it was very respectful. What do you make of that? What do you make of Alyssa Milano? I do, like I said, I don't like Ted Cruz, but I do give him credit for at least listening.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of either of them, although I will say that Alyssa Milano, of the Hollywood liberals, like, and I've found her to be one of the less offensive ones, just from the perspective that she's clearly intelligent and she's not quite as militant as a lot of the other ones. And honestly, too, like, she and I actually have crossed paths in person and a few times. I actually do some work with Moby, who I'm sure all the Republicans will listen to your show must love. But as a Republican, though, I'm a huge animal rights guy and a huge environmentalist. I am, and I don't care if that fault, you know, goes against certain Republican ideals. So, you know, on the gun control subject, I do tend probably to veer a little bit more toward what Alyssa Milano would actually believe, more so than Ted Cruz. I also just strongly dislike Ted Cruz. Like, I think I've mentioned this to you guys before, like, not to get on a tangent, there's no place for religion in politics, period. I don't care which side you're on. Like, stop with that. And I've found Ted Cruz to be one of the more ultra-religious politicians, which drives me insane.
I'm sick of it. I'm sick of people quoting the Bible. I'm sick of people using their religion. You know, I see Laura Ingraham, who I can't stand, on Fox News every night, wearing a cross on her neck.
It turns into a crux.
It's ridiculous.
So, Mr. X, you and I both support Donald Trump. Brian does not. But, you know, I have to give him some pushback here. Firing, and this is his 12th member of his cabinet that he's fired in the last 18 months, or in the last 3 years. Firing someone for disagreeing with you on one issue, it's a borderline dictatorial move. I mean, you look at Kim Jong-un, you look at Stalin, you look at Mussolini, they didn't have cabinets. Basically, anyone who disagreed with them, they weren't just fired, they were murdered. And, you know, in fact, Kim Jong-un, he has a pleasure squad, which is 2,000 young women who all they do is, like, their entire job is to pleasure him and his military. Do you think do you think that move was kind of dictatorial by Donald Trump, just firing Bolton over disagreeing over one issue?
I mean, you bring up Mussolini. Honestly, I have this vision of Trump in a room with his cabinet, and he tells one of his stupid jokes, and everyone starts laughing. And laughing, he fires them. I mean, who knows?
So you're talking like in Inglorious Bastards, like that scene.
No, that's a true thing about Mussolini. There were a lot of, it was either Mussolini or Stalin he gave a speech and everyone clapped, and the last person to stop clapping or something, he killed them or something like that. Like, it was that insane. But no, I mean, yeah, Trump, it's so silly to get rid of people around you who disagree with you, because then all you have is people saying yes to you. And when you make a dumb decision, then there's nobody to say no. And like, that's the sign of an unintelligent person, man. And I do support, I remain steadfast, as I say, in my support of Trump. But the sad thing is, I remain that way only because of the opposition. If the Democrats ran somebody out there that was intelligent and wasn't trying to ban red meat or trying to tell people to all turn in their cars and give them all free electric cars, like, if there were anybody sensible, I would immediately jump ship. It's just such a sad state of affairs that this knucklehead is, in my opinion, still probably our best option right now. And, you know, when I voted for Trump, my reason for voting for Trump at the time were twofold. Number one, Hillary's the Antichrist. And number two was the fact that I hoped that he wasn't bought and paid for. I could tell he was an idiot. I could tell he was emotional. I could tell he had no concept of PR, but he didn't seem to be, like Hillary, so in the pockets of the big pharma and, you know, the NRA. Now that he's been president, you know, I don't know if that's the case. Like, he's definitely influenced by these PACs just as much as anyone else is. But I don't know, guys. I mean, if the Democrats run anybody out there that I like, I mean, who knows? Maybe I will become a transgender Hollywood liberal and I can come on and, yeah, I don't know, man. But I don't see that happening.
Hey, are you concerned that the most likely next person to run the United States for the next 4.5 years is going to be 75 years old plus, Caucasian, and a male?
No. Why would I be concerned about that? Don't get me started on all that nonsense about, you know, like just because you're black or a woman does not necessarily mean you're more intelligent or less intelligent. Like, I don't care if it's a 12-year-old kid.
Well, hold on a second. I've always become the belief that if you're bald and you do a radio show, you're probably smarter than everybody else. That's just my opinion.
You know that I'm team bald. So
I definitely
agree with you on that one. And I mean, Trump shaving his head would not be the worst political decision he's ever made.
You know what? I might support him. I might support him if he did that and he got liposuction. I want to ask you, in the last week or so, I always ask you this question because I enjoy hearing your stories. Have you had any weird stories? Maybe you were on the set of the movie. Maybe you were mingling amongst other Hollywood elites, you know? I'm not calling you a Hollywood elite, but do you have any stories or any discussions that you've had in the last week that you'd like to share with us?
Speaking of elite, I describe myself as celebrity adjacent. Thank you very much. That's generally how I describe myself.
Fair enough.
Yeah, you know, so I have this ongoing project where the lead actress, the lead role, is supposed to be a very beautiful, very sexually aware person. And I've been pitched twice now to cast a legitimately transgender person as that role. And I just sit there like, well, what? Like, no, guys, like, no man. Like, I know that in Hollywood, there's this conception that, like, what the Hollywood elite believe is what 90% of movie viewers believe. But that's just so not the case. And I'm like, guys, listen, like, I get your social justice perspective of how cool and liberating and awesome and strong it would be to cast a man that's had a sex change as a female role. But, like, nobody wants to see that. Like, I'm sorry to tell you guys this. Like, 90% of America and the people who buy movie tickets are just not interested in that. And I think that's the big rude awakening that Hollywood's going to have after a lot of, and during, you know, this Me Too stuff and, like, a lot of this, like, let's only cast females, let's only cast black actors, you know. At some point, they're going to be like, well, the studios are going to say, you know, people aren't actually seeing these movies and they kind of suck. So let's go back to just casting the people that we want and that are best for the roles. So.
Yeah, I do think there's been a large disconnect with between reality and for Hollywood for a long time. Now, let's say you were to cast a transgender man or woman in that role. First of all, I don't know who you would cast. I've seen the show Euphoria a couple of times, and there's a transgender woman on that show, or I'm not sure how to, you know, woman, man on that show. Do you think that would actually make your chances of getting that film nominated for an Oscar better?
Oh, unquestionably. If like, because one thing that hasn't been done in Hollywood, and trust me, give it, like, as of 11/28 on whatever the date is today, it's probably going to be announced tomorrow. What hasn't been done, and I know that this is what Hollywood is really striving for, is there have been plenty of transgender actors and or whatever you actress semi, I don't know what you call transgender, but anyway, there have been plenty of them.
I don't either.
Plenty of those cast as transgenders. Like, okay, we wrote a role and it's a transgender male, and so we're going to cast a real transgender. What there hasn't been is, like, we write, like, a Sleepless in Seattle or The Notebook, and we literally cast the leading girl as a transgender, like a role that was written to be a woman, and then you cast a transgender as that role and you don't even really mention it. You're just like, well, you know, this is a woman. Like, I know that that's kind of the if you did that and wrote that and, you know, used that publicity, yeah, you would be in every festival, and Alyssa Milano would be, you know, probably kissing your ass. So,
well, for the record, I would let Alyssa Milano kiss any part of my body because I find her to be very attractive, but that's just my opinion. Anyway, Mr. X.
But that's pretty sexist of you, and you're probably going to get me too'd now.
Oh, absolutely. Listen, I am happy to say that Alyssa Milano is hot. I think Alyssa Milano is hot, and I have no problems with cross-dressers. There you go. You've had it from Brian Shapiro.
I know. Let me say one more thing. Sure. I had a very old-school actor come on my set on the last film I shot, and this was right when Me Too was really taking off about a year and a half ago. And this older guy walks on my set, and he says to me the first thing this older actor goes, "I'm not talking to a single woman on your set. I don't even want to look at them." And I was like, that's the shape of Hollywood. It's like, he just didn't want, you know, he didn't want to be misinterpreted.
He didn't want the risk.
He was just like,
well, that's stupid.
Don't want to talk to any women.
That's just ignorant. That's just ignorant, and that's nonsense. We always appreciate hearing those stories from those morons, from you, Mr. X, the Hollywood conservative. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great weekend, Mr. X, and we look forward to catching up with you next week, my friend.
See you guys at the library.
All right. All
right.
I'll go to the library.
See you, Mr.
X. Thank you, Mr. X, for the call. Appreciate it. We'll take a quick break. And when we come back, oh, my goodness. Well, first of all, I won a closest to the pin golf contest last night. I'll give you, and I actually beat a D1 golfer. I'll explain that coming up. And can you believe this, folks? There's actually a strip club in Las Vegas that's being sued and being accused of being a whorehouse. I will explain coming up next. You're listening to The Vegas Take on the all-new 101.5 FM, 720 AM, KDON.